Suriman, please start.
Okay. Now, can you hear me, all of you?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes.
Now, I yes, have the honor of starting the first webinar from Bengal Society of Hematology. And it is a topic of my heart. It is the commonest benign hematological disease to be treated by a hematologist, a very common problem that we encounter in our everyday life and have to admit quite a few times. And we have this grave duty of diagnosing it correctly and treating it correctly. Now, the disease has undergone a few transformations, including the name. The name has changed from its old incarnation of idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. It's become immune thrombocytopenic purpura, and it is the diagnostic workup has changed a bit. I'm sure our speakers will deal with all of these. There are new drugs in the armamentarium, and these have to be discussed and will be discussed today. And the third thing that is there, that there are new guidelines in place. So we have, after a long spell of time, we have a new ASH guideline, and that will also be discussed. And now I have this duty of welcoming all of you, my colleague speakers, all of you who are here are going to speak. My colleagues who will join in the webinar just to listen, and guests from Sri Lanka and Bangladesh who have registered to join, and all the students who will be listening, and I hope to gain a lot from this webinar. So I will ask Professor Dolai to take over and to carry on with the rest of the curriculum. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Soumila Chandra, the Honorable the President of the Bengal Society of the Hematology. So the webinar is the immune thrombocytopenia. In this webinar, there is a two lecture. One is the diagnosis and also the management of the newly diagnosed immune thrombocytopenia. Mainly focusing will be on the treatment of the newly diagnosed immune thrombocytopenia. Followed by there will be treatment of refractory immune thrombocytopenia. And followed by a panel discussion on the case based on the different important cases of the immune thrombocytopenia and subsequently the question and the answers. So to begin with this, the immune thrombocytopenia webinar, so I welcome you first speaker, Dr. Subhranil Baul. Dr. Subhranil Baul is the assistant professor of the hematology, Department of Hematology, Nilotan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. Dr. Subhranil is very young and energetic and also the good academic career. And I welcome you, Dr. Subhranil, to speak on the topic of treatment of newly diagnosed immune thrombocytopenia. Over the Dr. Subhranil.
Thank you, sir, for the kind introduction. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes.
So, Kalpesh, I will open the PPT, then I shall share the screen, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Select your window.
Yes, sir. Is visible? Hello?
No.
Okay. First, I shall open the PPT, right?
Yes.
Is visible now?
No.
I shall share screen. It's okay now? Correct?
No, it is not coming, sir.
It's coming?
No.
Yes, now
it is coming. Yes.
Make so I'm going to full screen, okay?
Yes.
Okay. So my topic is on, good evening, everybody. Thanks for the kind introduction. So my topic is today's management of newly diagnosed immune thrombocytopenia. So let's start. So as Dr. Sharmila Chandra, our honorable chairman of the Bengal Society of Hematology, has told that the terminology has changed. The old, it was idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. Now it has changed to primary immune thrombocytopenia, the new naming of the disease. So the epidemiology, if I come to the epidemiology of a newly diagnosed ITP, the incidence is very low. It's 0.2 to 0.4 new cases per 10,000 year in adults and 0.2 to 0.7 for 10,000 year in children. The median age of ITP in adults is in 50 to 55 years. And if we consider the gender in pediatric, the ITP, the boys are more often affected. In middle age, the women are more likely affected. And after age 60 years, the men predominant again. There is a seasonal variability. It is more common in spring and summer. And in also in the early winter months where the viral infections trigger ITP. Ethnic variability shows the African Americans are more less affected than the Asia Pacific region, and it's an orphan disease because of the rarity. So my outline of talk will be platelet hemostasis, pathogenesis, clinical manifestations, diagnosis and laboratory evaluation, prognosis and risk factors, therapeutic intervention and other important issues. So without wasting time, I go to platelet hemostasis. We all know the platelets play a role in primary hemostasis with platelet addition, safe change, granule release, recruitment and aggregation and platelet hemostatic plaque. We all know from our pathology days. Now, what is the primary hemostasis defect leads to mucocutaneous bleeding due to decreased platelet count? If the platelet count is normal, then we come to other differentials like von Willebrand disease due to platelet function defects or due to the vessel wall defects, which are not of concern today. We are concerned with low platelet count in primary immune thrombocytopenia. Next, I have dealt with only the pathogenesis. Now I will deal with the pathophysiology. It's an autoimmune disease against platelets and megakaryocytes. Remember, megakaryocytes are also damaged by the autoimmunity. So platelet autoantibodies, T lymphocytes, and impaired thrombopoiesis. I have a beautiful cartoon depicting all the complete complex pathophysiology. There is dysregulation of TH helper cells. There is more towards TH1 and TH17 helper cells, more polarity towards that, and downregulation of Tregs. There is damage to the megakaryocyte function, impaired megakaryocyte maturation and reduced platelet production. And there is also cytotoxic T cells having role. And we all know the role of Fc gamma receptors where the platelets are destroyed by the antibodies already produced. So the ITP new terminology, what is newly diagnosed today at the top? Hello? Yes, now it's clear. Hello? Up till now, it was fine, Kalpesh?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes.
Fine then. So ITP, the new terminology, the topic of interest of mine is newly diagnosed, which is of less than 3 month duration. The persistent is 3 to 12 months. The chronic is of more than 12 months. And refractory thrombocytopenia is defined post-splenectomy. My topic of interest is newly diagnosed and is all manifestations, which I will address in subsequent slides. So next, I will come to the clinical manifestations. The symptoms mostly in the form of petechiae, mostly in the form of wet purpura, and also in the bruise form of bruise. So you can see in this cartoon that there is petechiae, bruises, and wet purpura. And if you can see, if we grade them into bleeding, the grade one, which is minor bleeding, which is no mucosal bleeding is there. The petechiae is less than 100 total, less than five small bruises, each less than 3 centimeter diameter. What is a mild bruise? Grade two or mild, no mucosal bleeding in both the conditions. The petechiae is more than 100 in total, more than 5 large bruises, and grade 3 moderate overt mucosal bleeding, troublesome lifestyle. Grade 4 is severe, that is mucosal bleeding and suspected internal hemorrhage, which is a medical emergency in newly diagnosed ITP. Now, clinical manifestations in a large registry of children with newly diagnosed ITP, the following bleeding manifestations were reported. The cutaneous petechiae purpura or bruising that I have shown in the last slide is 86% is the most common presentation, followed by oral bleeding of 19%, nasal bleed of 20%, and no bleeding in ITP, that is low platelet count, that is 9%. Menstrual, gastrointestinal, urinary bleeding is seen in less than 3% of cases. And in a UK survey, the symptoms, the very interesting presentation, which shows that platelet count and symptoms such presentation. Generally, the most of the symptoms you will find is when the platelet count is less than 10,000 and between 10 to 19,000, with more platelet count, the symptoms are less. And severity of bleed, it has been found that the ICH or the intracranial bleed has been reported in 1.4% of adults and 0.1% to 4% in children with newly diagnosed ITP. Very rare, but no, unlikely. Severe bleeding is reported in 9.5% of adults and 20.2% of children. It's more in children than the severe bleeding, but ICH, which is quite fatal, is more in adults compared to children. Next, I will talk about the diagnosis and laboratory evaluation of newly diagnosed ITP. So how will you clinically clinch the diagnosis? It's sudden onset of petechial rash or bruising in an otherwise well-appearing child or adult. The platelet count definition of ITP is that should be less than 1 lakh per microliter, normal complete blood count with normal differential white count, hemoglobin and reticulocyte count. No abnormalities on the peripheral smear after review by an experienced practitioner in hematology. No evidence of hemolysis or blast in the smear. Atypical lymphocytes from viral infections are acceptable. This needs an expert hematopathologist, and a direct Coombs test should be negative for further treatment intervention or to rule out the Evans syndrome. So what are the things to be ruled out? Check for clinically examine the lymph nodes, check, palpate the liver, palpate the spleen, examine for the stigmata of Fanconi anemia, see, check for systemic examine symptoms like fever, anorexia, bone or joint pain, headache or weight loss, systemic disease, a long-standing history of thrombocytopenia or atypical bleeding, family history of thrombocytopenia, bleeding of unknown etiology. All this has to be ruled out by your clinical examination and clinical history taking, and mostly it's a diagnosis of exclusion. And there is some also some say that give a trial of IVIG possible. If response is there, then probably it's ITP, but it's not so strong an evidence as a diagnostic clincher. So in this slide, I want to mention two investigations which are presently mentioned in the new guidelines, that is quantitative IgG level measurement, which is done predominantly in children. Why we should do it is that it's not done in newly diagnosed. It is probably done in the chronic ITP, is where we do the quantitative immunoglobulin level measurement. And sometimes we do this quantitative IgG level measurement before giving IVIG also, because some are IgA deficient. And H. pylori testing is also, they have mentioned regarding this, is that it should be done in appropriate geographic areas where H. pylori is prevalent, but it's not mandatory in children at all. And if there is not response to the initial therapy, H. pylori testing can be done in the chronic stage in children. Rest all investigations are common, I have already discussed. Now, it's a very $1 million question. Shall I do a bone marrow examination? When shall I do it? Thrombocytopenia, if there is thrombocytopenia, fine. Then we have abnormal leukocyte or erythrocyte parameters, go for it. If there's atypical history like fever, weight loss, lymph nodes enlargement, hepatosplenomegaly, any patient more than 60 years, go for bone marrow examination, to rule out MDS or bone marrow failure or ICAS or before splenectomy, to rule out alternative diagnosis with the greatest certainty before this irreversible procedure. So this is a picture where I peripheral smear showing a single platelet and bone marrow examination showing plenty of megakaryocytes. So next I will talk on prognosis and risk factors, and what are the prognosis and risk inductors? What are the indicators for severe hemorrhage in a newly diagnosed ITP? That is platelet count less than 20,000, if the patient has multiple hematoma, wet purpura, you should check the oral cavity, history of prior severe bleedings, hematuria, no response to steroids, infection, fever, and age more than 60 years. These are the high risk indicators for severe hemorrhage. And prognosis and risk indicators for chronicity, that is indicators for chance of self-limited course in child, if the patient is child, young adult, if there's a preceding infection, if there's an abrupt onset, an initial presentation with acute bleeding symptoms, then the chances of chronicity are less. But chronicity is more in adults if more than 60 years old, no preceding infection or other disorder, insidious onset, onset with only minor bleeding symptoms, or incidental thrombocytopenia without bleeding at all. So these are the chances of chronicity. Next, I will, most important part is the therapeutic intervention. What are my goals of therapy? My goals of therapy should be individualized to the patient and the phase of the disease. My phase is early phase. So treatment should maintain a target platelet level of 20 to 30,000 at least of symptomatic patients. Treatment should be with minimal toxicity. Treatment should optimize the health-related quality of life. Very important. The present guidelines very much stress on the health-related quality of life of each patient. The initial treatment we do with anti-D, corticosteroid, preferably with dexamethasone, methylprednisolone, and prednisolone, and IVIG. So the initial treatment of newly diagnosed patients, what we will do in adult with no or minor bleeding. If the platelet count is more than 30,000, no need to panic, observe the patient. If the platelet count is 30,000 and there is a minor mucocutaneous bleed, treat with steroids, preferably with dexamethasone or prednisolone. If the platelet count is less than 20,000, new diagnosis, admit the patient and begin treatment. An established patient who is asymptomatic or minor bleeding, treat as an outpatient. So platelet count less than 20,000 should be hospitalized and treatment should be immediately prioritized. For children, the platelet count is less than 20,000, no bleeding, outpatient observation. Platelet count more than 20,000, no bleeding, outpatient observation. For children with non-life threatening bleeding, all platelet counts, treatment with prednisolone for 2 to 4 milligrams per into 5 to 7 days. Refractory or steroid dependent thrombopoietin receptor agonist, which Dr. Saiketh will address. Next, I will come to the most important thing about the corticosteroid. Here, I will ask all the listeners to be a little patient and be careful. The prednisolone dose is at 1 milligram per kg in adult. Maximum dose, if it is 80 milligram, even if a person is weighing 90 kg, don't exceed beyond 80 milligram. Maximum duration you will go for is for 2 weeks or maximum of 3 weeks. Dexamethasone 40 milligram for 4 days, repeated up to 3 times. Platelet count should be 50,000, the prednisolone tapered by 6 weeks, maximum 80. Even if the platelet count is falling off beyond that, also taper by 6 weeks. Don't extend beyond 8 weeks. If there is no response to the initial response within 2 weeks, check platelet count daily. The prednisolone should be tapered rapidly over 1 week and stopped. For children, the corticosteroids are used in only grade 1 and grade 2 bleeding, not in grade 3, 4 that I have already mentioned. The prednisolone dose is at 4 mg per kg in 3 to 4 divided doses for 4 days. Maximum daily dose if you use for 4 days only is 200 mg, or else if you want to use for 1 to 2 mg, maximum 80 mg, that is for 1 to 2 weeks. The same other two, if the platelet count rises above to 50,000, tapered by 3 weeks. If there is no response by 2 weeks, then it should be stopped over 1 week and stopped immediately. Next is IVIG. The dose we all know is 0.4 gram per kilogram of body weight intravenously for 5 days, or 1 gram into 1 to 2 days. IVIG is 10%. Recently, some 10 grams are available. It's as effective as 5 grams with response rate of 72% vis-a-vis to 80.7. The onset of action is in 4 days. The adverse effects are headache, aseptic meningitis, and renal failure. And there are some studies which have shown that reduced IVIG response to anti-GPIB9 antibodies to the platelets. But there is a mixture of antibodies, so it's very difficult to ascertain. Transient response lasts only 1 to 4 weeks in 80%. Treatment can be repeated. Next is IV anti-D. See, the response is 80%. The duration, the onset of action is in 3 to 7 days. 1/3 of patients have acceptable platelet threshold after 2 to 6 weeks. The anti-D dose has been recently modified to 50 microgram per kg from the traditional 75 microgram per kg, but it has overall response rate of 65% with a median duration of remission of 25 days. But it has unique side effects like chills, phyrexia, and decreased hemoglobin. Another important thing is that the patient should be blood group Rh positive, the patient should not be splenectomized, and patients should have no active autoimmune hemolysis and anemia. There is a black box warning that risk of death due to acute respiratory failure and acute renal insufficiency and DIC is always there, and administration of IV anti-D and steroids sometimes minimize the side effects, and it is not available in Europe. Recommendations for life-threatening bleed: we use combinations of IV corticosteroids, IVIG, and sometimes we can also use platelet transfusions to mitigate the risk. If there is no response, we can add TPORA, and there are some studies with IV vincristine, vinblastine. You can use tranexamic acid. You can also very rarely do emergency splenectomy. So now the definition of response, which has changed quite few, it has changed quite from what we used to know. What is a durable response? It's a platelet count more than 30,000 and at least doubling of baseline at 6 months. Early response, that's platelet count more than 30,000, at least doubling of baseline at 1 week. What is initial response? Platelet count more than 30,000 and at least doubling of baseline at 1 month. What is remission? Platelet count more than 1 lakh at 12 months. Now, coming to other important issues in ITP. So, suppose a patient requires an emergency surgery. So, what I will do? I will go for an IVIG or I will go for a steroid. And there are certain important issues, like for a surgery of brain or posterior of eye, we need a platelet count of 1 lakh. It is not graded as a very strong evidence, but this is the safe one. Major non-neuroactional surgery is around 50,000. For central line placement, for enteroscopy, for bronchoscopy, we come across, we need a platelet count of 20,000. For prophylaxis of spontaneous bleeding, we have discussed, it is 10,000. Next, there are some recommendations for the safe platelet count. I think dental extraction is 30,000, all are 30,000. For major neurosurgery, we need a platelet count of more than 1 lakh. And one important thing I want to mention, for a single antiplatelet agent, a platelet count of 30 to 50,000. And for dual antiplatelet therapy, along with an anticoagulant, we need a platelet count of more than 50 to 70,000. So therapeutic options during pregnancy, I don't have much time in my hand to discuss everything in detail. The first line therapy is IVIG and steroids. Those are mostly safe. There is relative contraindications for anti-D, azathioprine, cyclosporine, TPORA, and it needs a separate seminar some other day to discuss the issues. So whatever the talk is, if we don't discuss the present scenario, the COVID-19 associated immune therapy, the talk is not complete. So significant thrombocytopenia is uncommon in COVID-19 positive patient until end stage disease. Very low platelet count of 20,000 or a sudden fall in the platelet count of more than 50% over 24 to 48 hours may indicate an immune etiology. Other causes of immune thrombocytopenia, such as heat, because we use heparin, because it's a procoagulant state, MAHA, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, and drugs should be considered before a diagnosis of ITP is made. Little evidence is to inform the optimal management. If the patient is negative for COVID-19, go for TPORA, may be preferred. If the positive for COVID-19, TPORA is not so preferred, because TPORA can give to DVT, TPORA can lead to also hepatotoxicity, which is difficult to detect. The safe agents are IVIG, tranexamic acid can be given, platelet transfusion can be given in life-threatening bleed. And if we want to use steroid, use it at a very starting low dose of 20 milligram because of its immunosuppressive properties. Now, I have come across a very interesting paper which I thought mentioned. This is a patient where this has been shown that in 8 women patients, it was published in Blood. It has been found that very severe iron deficiency can give rise to low platelet count, where the platelet count improved with IV iron or oral iron supplement rather than giving a treatment for ITP with steroids or IVIG. But why profound iron deficiency can seldom lead to thrombocytopenia, whereas mild iron deficiency often leads to thrombocytosis, needs further investigation. Quite a lot of things to know for us still. So before I end, I should conclude, don't overtreat. Safe platelet count is above 30,000 cubic millimeter. Rituximab and steroids are not preferred in newly diagnosed ITP. TPORA not yet recommended in newly diagnosed ITP. Few trials are there. Prioritized outcomes such as health-related quality of life in randomized controlled trials are used of standardized outcomes with regard to platelet outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Subranil, for presenting the beautiful slide and the content of this topic, the immune thrombocytopenia, the newly diagnosed. Thank you, sir. We'll take the question at the end of the lecture after finishing the panel discussion. So there was the question is coming from the audience. So we'll discuss later. So then we'll move into the lecture number two. The lecture number two is after the management of the newly diagnosed immune thrombocytopenia. So the next important thing is that sometimes it is very difficult to manage the patient with immune thrombocytopenia if it is failure of the first line of the therapy. Then the patient enters to the phase of the persistent ITP, then the chronic ITP, and then also we call the refractory immune thrombocytopenia. So basically the immune and the refractory thrombocytopenia is a nightmare of the physician, and also there is a lot of the morbidity of the patient perspective. So to highlight this topic, the management of the refractory immune thrombocytopenia, Dr. Soikar Dutta, the consultant hematologist, and he is working in the North Bengal Medical College, and he is also the young and energetic, has a good academic career. And Dr. Soikar, please.
Thank you, sir, for kind introduction. I should share this screen first, no?
Yes. No, you have to open your presentation first.
It's open already.
Yeah, share the screen. Select your window. Yes, come in.
Make it full visible?
Yes, make it full screen, sir. Perfect, sir.
Okay. I'm starting management of refractory immune thrombocytopenia. Now, what is refractory ITP? Previously, the definition was failure of splenectomy, but now splenectomy rates are declined. So In 2020, the definition is patient didn't respond to more than two or more than two lines of treatment, and there's no single medication to which they respond, that their platelet count is always low and accompanied by bleeding. This is the new definition for refractory ITP. Now, when I'm saying refractory ITP, I always ask myself, am I right about, correct about my diagnosis? Is it primary ITP or is it something else? So it may be other thing, like common misdiagnosis are secondary ITP, myelodysplastic syndrome, inherited thrombocytopenia, drug-induced thrombocytopenia, or other bone marrow failure syndromes. In secondary ITP, these are the common causes. Dr. Subramanian already said that we should do immunoglobulin level in refractory ITP because patient may have common variable immunodeficiency. Autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome patients are young patient with lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly. Exacerbation usually gives symptoms of cardiovascular disease, and we do hepatitis C and HIV testing. H. pylori testing we can do in case of refractory thrombocytopenia by stool antigen or urea breath test if available, but usually it is done by biopsy, which is not possible in severe thrombocytopenia. And drug history is very important. Inherited thrombocytopenia may be mistaken as ITP, Wishcott-Ehlers syndrome, Burnett-Schuller thrombocytopenia with absent red clay, gray platelet syndrome, MOH9 related disease, von Willebrand type 2B or platelet time volume dependent disease. This all can be mistaken as ITP. For this, we have to take detailed history, history of childhood bleeding, family history. We have to see the platelet morphology, which is characteristic in case of gray platelet syndrome, large platelet seen in Barnard-Schuller syndrome, Wishcott-Ehlers syndrome, may present eczema, and von Willebrand disease. And they need platelet function test, and most of the cases, we may need genetic testing to diagnose this test. And inherited bone marrow failure syndrome like Fanconi anemia, congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, dyskeratosis congenita, and SDS or Schwarzman-Diamond syndrome can initially present with thrombocytopenia. So for refractory ITP, we should do bone marrow biopsy to see the patient have bone marrow failure syndrome or not. Now, when I'm sure it's ITP, it's a refractory ITP, these are my therapeutic approaches, therapeutic armamentarium. These different drugs are available which reduce immunoglobulin G production or reduce FC-mediated clearance of platelet, or some drug increases platelet production, or splenectomy, which causes removal of site of platelet clearance. Now, we have this outdated guideline, which was published in 2010-11. We have new international consensus report and new ASH guideline in 2019. And this guideline says for subsequent treatment, we have robust evidence for this medical therapy, L-thrombopag, avatrombopag, rumiplostim, fostamatimib, and rituximab. For the other drugs, which we are using for many days, we don't have robust evidence. For surgical therapy, we have splenectomy. Now, new ASH guidelines says defer splenectomy for at least 1 year, and they give immense importance on patient decisions, patient's value and preferences. They said rituximab to be used before splenectomy, thrombopoietin receptor agonist to be used before rituximab, But they also said thrombopoietin receptor agonist and splenectomy, both can be used. Any of this can be used in ITP more than duration of more than 3 months. And if we are using TPORA, then any of this L-thrombopag or rumiplostim can be used. Now, there is a bit confusion that TPORA and splenectomy are in same line, and here TPORA before rituximab and rituximab before splenectomy. This is because we don't have very high quality of evidence. When we don't have high quality of evidence, in democratic country, it is always by voting. So as expert voted, and the 16 experts voted for rituximab over splenectomy, 8 experts voted for TPORA over rituximab. But all the 12 experts said that TPORA or splenectomy both can be used. And this last line is very important, that all will be influenced by patient preference. country like us, splenectomy would be very important because lots of poor patients. Like here, patient preference is very important. When patient don't want surgery and want a durable response, then our options are TPO-RA. If patient don't want long-term medication, then we cannot give bromiplostin or eltromobeg, then we have to give rituximab and splenectomy. Patient is agreed for surgery, then splenectomy, otherwise rituximab. Thus, with patient value and preference, we would select the treatment. Now, this is our country when lots of people below poverty levels, though splenectomy is falling out of preference, it's important for our country. Initial response rate of splenectomy is up to 90%, at 10 years, 78%, and at 20 years, it's still 67%. So very good response with our good old friend splenectomy. Now, rituximab response is around 60%, at 1 year, 40%, but at 5 years, only 20%. If we want to use rituximab, it's better to use early in the course of disease, because with long duration of disease, it probably less working. And splenectomy patient tend to relapse earlier. Low dose rituximab equally effective. This is our paper when I was in ISTM. We published this study. We compare standard versus low dose rituximab, and both of this work well, similar efficacy in chronic ITP. Now, TPO-RA agonist, these are sensation of the day. So, romiplostin and eltromopac. Romiplostin act in distal end of thrombopoietin receptor, and eltromopac work as in this transmembrane region, and they increase platelet production. Eltromopac has off-target level, off-target effects, and romiplostin, which is subcutaneous, eltromopac and avatromopac can be used oral therapy. And if you want a oral therapy which can be given in hepatic dysfunction, this is avatromopac. And in renal failure, you can use any of these. And for eltromopac, we have dietary restriction at least 2 hours after and 1 hour before food, and with dietary product, 4 hour gap with dietary product to be given with eltromopac. And none of this can be used in pregnancy. This is the long-term study of eltromopac, extend study final result, which show 85% response and 25% achieve continuous response. And drug discontinuation due to hepatotoxicity on only 3%, bone marrow fibrosis, thromboembolic event, and cataract is not significant with eltromopac. This is the long-term treatment effect for romiplostin, published in 2013. This 5-year follow-up, and it showed that at 92% visit, patient had platelet more than 50,000, and thromboembolism and bone marrow fibrosis rate are around 6%. And there is no need of routine bone marrow examination to assess bone marrow fibrosis in case of TPO-RA. And thromboembolism is not significantly increased in case in when compared to placebo. Now, can patient go into remission with TPO-RA, or can we stop this drug, romiplostin or eltromobeg? Yes, we can. For romiplostin, there is 28% response rate when we stop the drug. And for eltromobeg, this study shows 53% patient maintain response for 6 months when he stopped the drug. And it works in splenectomized patients also. There are different drug discontinuation trial which showed different response rates. Some showed response rate up to 100%. All patients responded, all patients maintained a stable platelet count after discontinuation of drugs. Now, how do you discontinue these drugs, romiplostin or eltromobeg? Like, patient is in stable platelet count with 50 milligram dose of eltromobeg, or like 6 microgram per kg dose of romiplostin. How do you start tapering? This is the There is no standard protocol for discontinuation. This article is for L-thrombobag, which suggested that first 6 months, we should be cautious. We should not alter that dose. When we have a stable platelet response, we have platelet more than 50,000 and less than 2 lakhs over a period of time of 6 months, then only we should try for discontinuation and tapering of this drug. And for L-thrombobag, we should reduce dose by 25 milligram as suggested by this article, but there are other protocol also available. And 25 milligram every 4 days should be the minimum dose before we ultimately interrupt the treatment. And they tapered this L-thrombobag over an 8-week period. This is the consensus summary of expert opinion. This was published in EHA as abstract. This is the tapering of discontinuation of TPURA, both L-thrombobag and romiplostin. This is for romiplostin and this is for L-thrombobag. This number are actually number of expert. So how different expert opine differently for this discontinuation approach. Though there is no consensus, most of the experts showed that romiplostin should be discontinued, first tapered 1 milligram per kg weekly, and for L-thrombobag, some said like start tapering. If you are in 50 milligram per day, then we can give 50 and 25 alternate days. Some said 37.5 milligrams, some said 25 milligram daily. But in our country, possibly 12.5 milligram dose is not available, so a bit difficult for us. Now, how we monitor the platelet when we start tapering? Most are saying that we should do platelet count at least once in 14 days. And after discontinuation, we should monitor, when we monitor, first do platelet count weekly for first month, then every weekly, then we can increase the gap. But for discontinuing this TPORA, we must remember that we need to have a stable platelet count of at least 50,000, preferably 1 lakh for 6 months before we start tapering. And we can taper in different regimen. Like if you want to taper first, you can taper in 1 to 2 months. You can taper slow, like 3 to 6 months. And we can taper also very slow, like 6 to 12 months. Different tapering regimen are available. And you should dose according your plan. Like I'm planning to taper over 6 months, then I will reduce the dose every month. But if you want rather rapid tapering, like within 2 months, then you can taper this drug, reduce the doses every 2 weeks. Now switching off TPURA. Now, like your romiplostin is not working, you are giving L-thrombobag, response is 100%, and your L-thrombobag is not working, you are giving romiplostin, 66 to 80% response in different study. And one study showed that when romiplostin is not working in its maximum dose, adding of a small dose of steroid like 2.5 or 5 milligram can produce significant effect on platelet. Now this is a quite new drug, now approved by FDA for fostamatinib, spleen tyrosine kinase inhibitor. It's an oral drug given 100 milligram BD approved for chronic ITP, and where thrombopoietin receptor agonist failed to respond, and those 17% patient produced stable response. So we can use this drug in case of TPURA failure. Major side effects are diarrhea, hypertension, and it doesn't work in 12 weeks, we should discontinue this drug. These are very familiar drug. We have used this drug for many years. Dapsone we use quite frequently, produce response rate around 55%. For danazol, response rate is around 65%. We have immunosuppressive drug like cyclosporine or MMF. If you are using immunosuppressive agent, probably MMF is better than cyclosporine because side effect profile is good for MMF. And there are combination therapy. This combination therapy came up in pre-TPO-RA era. People use CHOV, vinblastine, danazol combination. This is an AIM study, 25% response at 6 months. Danazol plus azathioprine produce 60% response, a different combination of different drugs. If our first rituximab failed, first rituximab worked, but then patient relapsed, then we can use second dose of rituximab. It produced 70% initial response and 45% response at 1 year. We can use azathioprine, CSA, mycophenolate, mofetil, all the drugs which act on T cell, but by different mechanism. It reduced dose, azathioprine is 2 mg per kg, CSA with 2 mg per kg, or MMF 1 to 2 gram per day. It produced excellent response for refractory ITP. Other combination therapy like DEXA, cyclosporine, and low dose rituximab, 100 mg weekly, 4 doses, produce 60% response at 6 months. This is only single 1 month of therapy, like 4 doses, 40 mg DEXA, 4 weeks of CSA and 4 doses of rituximab. And danazol plus ATRA, this is a Chinese study. If you don't like China, don't use it, but they showed 62% response rate. Now it's era of TPO-RA. We can combine TPO-RA with immunosuppressive agent like cyclosporine or MMF. We can use TPO-RA with FC blocking agent like fostamatinib, or all three at a time. Even we can combine two TPO-RA, but we do not have much evidence for this. This is my last slide. With this, I will end this session on refractory ITP. Thank you for patience.
Thank you, Dr. Soikot, for a wonderful discussion on the refractory ITP. There is a couple of questions will be discussed at the end of the panel discussion. And I think we'll move to our important session of the webinar of the immune thrombocytopenia, that is the panel discussions. Means from scratch to the bedside, and how we are managing the patient of immune thrombocytopenia in our clinic, in our hospital, and basically the case-based panel discussion. And this case-based panel discussion, the moderator is Professor Siddhartha Shankar Roy. And Professor Siddhartha Shankar Roy is the professor of the Hematology, Institute of Hematology and the Transfusion Medicine, Kolkata. And he is a senior professor and senior hematologist in Kolkata, and he has a brilliant academic career. And I hand over to Dr. Siddhartha Shankar Roy.
Thank you, Professor Dole. First of all, I want to thanks Bengal Society of Hematology and also Professor Tupan Dole for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are.
Okay. So I would like to thank Tufan and the organizer for giving me this opportunity. And I'm very pleased. It gives me immense pleasure to see the previous two presentations because it makes my job much easier, because most of the things I was planning to discuss in my case-based discussion almost covered. But still, maybe it will be somewhat of rehearsal like the thing, so that it will keep an impression which will be long lasting for the other students and whoever practicing hematology, the junior fellows. So that's why I will continue and start the panel discussions. Along with me, my eminent panelists are Dr. Ankita Sen. She is a consultant hematologist and hemato-oncologist attached to Neelotpan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. She did a DM in clinical hematology from Neelotpan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. Dr. Soumo Mukherjee, who did DM in clinical hematology from Neelotpan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. He is working as a consultant hematologist in Ruby General Hospital, Kolkata, AMRI Mukundapur. He was formerly attached to Bardhaman Medical College as an assistant professor, and his subject of interest in lymphoma, myeloma, ITP. Also, there is Dr. Shajia Gulsan, who is DCH, MD, DM in clinical hematology, did from, again, from Nilakant Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. She is consultant hematologist, PLS Hospital. Along with my student, Dr. Joshua C. Chakraborty, who completed his DM from my institution, the Institute of Hematology and Transfusion Medicine. And his special interest is in hemophilia and other bleeding disorders. And I'm proud that I was his guide during his thesis work and other thing. Okay, thanks Joshua for joining with us. So without spending much time, I will go to my case presentation. So I would request Kalpesh, are you there? Can you just start my slides, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so next slide, please. So I'll go through a case-based discussion. This is a practical case which I faced in our day-to-day workup. This is a 36-year-old female, mother of two. She was generally good health, but recently began to feel somewhat tired and noticed bruises without any trauma. But she didn't have any history of menorrhagia. When she came to the physician, there was petechia and ecchymosis, and also there was bleeding in the mouth. On clinical examination, there was no organomegaly or lymphadenopathy, and routine CBC was determined normal except very low platelet count, less than 10,000, and there were reactive lymphocytes on the peripheral smear. Next slide, please. So my question to first panelist, Dr. Shajia, what all tests will you ask for, and how are they going to help you in the diagnosis? Next slide, please. Next slide. And what is your opinion about the role of bone marrow examination? And is there any role of antiplatelet antibody testing? And is there any role of percentage of immature platelet function and mean platelet volume? So over to Dr. Shajia. Are you there, Shajia? Hello. She was here. Yeah.
Audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Am I audible?
Yeah, but your video is not working.
Video is not working?
Yes, now
it is. Is it okay working. Now?
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
So next slide, please. Okay, Shajia, continue.
So this is a 36-year-old female who has two children. She's presented with recent onset bleed. And we have to go through a history once again, a detailed clinical and a history and an examination. I would like to know whether she had any recent history of viral infection, history of any bone pain, any arthritis.
No, nothing.
Nothing like that.
Yeah.
So on examination, there was no lymphadenopathy, no hepatosplenomegaly.
Yeah.
That's right. So careful examination of peripheral blood smear does not reveal any other WBC immaturity.
No, there was a few reactive lymphocytes.
Only a few reactive lymphocytes.
Yes.
Yes, that might reflect recent viral infection. Otherwise, there were no other blasts or any other cystocytes or any other abnormality on the peripheral smear.
Yeah.
Yes. So this is a case of isolated thrombocytopenia. And I also would like to know if she was on any drugs which would have caused this thrombocytopenia.
No. She was otherwise healthy. She didn't have any problem. She was not on any drug.
So this seems to be a case of typical primary ITP, immune thrombocytopenia.
And her routine biochemistry was normal. ANA was negative and blood-borne viral screening was negative.
Viral serology was negative. And ANA was negative.
Okay, next slide, yes. Please. Next slide, okay. Now continue, Shajia.
Yes, sir. So I would just like to, being a case of thrombocytopenia, isolated thrombocytopenia, which is the most important is to examine the smear and rule out pseudothrombocytopenia and other causes of thrombocytopenia. Because primary ITP is essentially a clinical diagnosis and a diagnosis of exclusion, mainly. So after the first smear, I would like to do a, you have already done HIV and HCV. H. pylori testing is not recommended clinically normally. And also according to the recent recommendations, a bone marrow test is not recommended until unless there are some atypical features like bone pain or prolonged fever or a weight loss or arthritis or anything causing thinking of secondary, which might point to a secondary cause of ITP or any other atypical causes of leukemia or any other thing. So, and looking at the counter, what you're saying is the megakaryocyte platelet function test and the platelet, your volume, it is usually increased. The peripheral smear, we get some large platelets, and there is not, although it points to your points to a diagnosis, might point to a diagnosis of an increased platelet volume and a platelet distribution weight, or increased immature platelet function. Otherwise, it does not, I mean, it might indicate a cause of thrombocytopenia ITP, but it is not absolutely diagnostic. In fact, in ITP, there is no one single test which can say that is absolutely this one clinches the diagnosis of ITP. And regarding another question which you had was, bone marrow examination is not recommended at present for a typical case of ITP.
May I add a few things? Actually, usually that's what you have said, right? That bone marrow usually we do not do. And I personally feel that if I can see the slide myself, then I usually do not advise. But if there is, yes, as already said, yes. Yeah, if we cannot.
If you're sure with the smear, then we may not go for it.
And if we can give IVIGG also, there is no need of doing bone marrow. We can see the response. And if you are planning to give steroids, and I am not sure about the bone marrow peripheral smear who has seen the quality of the pathologist, then it is better to do a bone marrow aspiration.
Exactly, sir. We want to make sure we have a look at the smear. And if we are sure by that, and then we can go ahead without doing a bone marrow itself. Okay. And regarding your antibody testing, that is also has a very low sensitivity.
Low sensitivity,
and that is also not recommended in diagnosis.
Yes. Okay. So next slide, please. So these are the recommendations that So now next question is to Dr. Ankita. Are you there?
Yeah. Yes, sir. I'm there.
Yeah. Welcome to the meeting.
Thank you, sir.
So now question to you, how are you planning to treat this patient? Although it is not recommended, but as there are a few reactive lymphocytes, and I could not see the slide personally, so I did the bone marrow. And bone marrow shows features of megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia. Okay, so now how are you planning to treat this patient? And when do you give injection IVIGG? And role of anti-D immunoglobulin is there, and role of platelet transfusion? These are the four questions.
Right, sir. I'll take them one by one. Good evening to the organizers, the faculty, and to all the attendees. So I'll take up the questions one by one. So we already know that this patient has been diagnosed with megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia or primary ITP in this case. So since the patient had presented with mucosal bleeding, so that per se is pointing that the platelet count is very low, likely less than 10,000. So we would have to increase the platelets as well as stop the bleeding, immediate measures. So if the cost is not a constraint, I would like to go for IVIG for this patient at the dose of 1 gram per kg for day one, and possibly followed again the following day. And this would be followed by prednisolone in case of this lady at a dose of 1 mg per kg per day. However, if possibly finances might be an issue, so we can also start with methyl prednisolone for the first 3 days at 1 gram per day, and that to be followed by prednisolone again. And like our previous speaker, Dr. Baul, has already shown the days to response and how we should monitor. Accordingly, we should follow up this patient so that we can see whether the platelets are increasing, and more importantly, whether the bleeding is being controlled, since we normally treat the patient and not the number as such. And in this context, sir has also asked whether we are giving injection IVIG. So I already mentioned that we would prefer to treat this patient with IVIG. But we can also, basically IVIG is given in case of patients where urgent control of bleeding and urgent control or increase in platelet counts is required, since the time to response is 2 to 3 days only. And apart from IVIG, for the same thing, anti-D immunoglobulin may also be used. So anti-D immunoglobulin comes with certain caveats. It cannot be given to everybody. The patient should be Rh positive. So we must find out the blood group of this patient first, and also the hemoglobin level. It should be at least 10 gram per DL, but a number of literature also mention for 8 gram per DL. But personally, I'd like to keep it on the higher side. Since whenever we are using anti-D IgIg, we would have to sacrifice the RBC so that the platelet counts are sustained. And in case of severe bleeding episodes, for example, this patient has mucosal hemorrhages. She doesn't have anything else like CNS bleeds or GI bleeding. But in case of certain other emergency situations like this, or in case of this patient, possibly on the first day after judging the patient's clinical appearance, we might also have to give platelet transfusions as an emergency measure, along with the previously mentioned measures. And apart from these targeted therapies, which have been discussed, tranexamic acid, we all know, should also be given for this patient. And tranexamic acid, also we have to make sure that there is no hematuria for the patient. That would be a contraindication. So, I would just like to say that for this patient, probably we should start with IVIG and follow it up with prednisolone.
Okay. So next slide, please. Next slide. So this is the plan of action, what Dr. Ankita told you. There is first line, second line, and third line. Okay, next slide, please. So in this patient, in this case, he was given IVIGG followed by oral prednisolone. Patient is responded initially, but later platelet count drops again to 10,000 after 1.5 months. She was at that time was tapering dose of prednisolone to 10 milligram per day. Next slide, please. So, Dr. Jasoshi, what is your diagnosis now? And if the bone marrow was not done initially, will you do bone marrow now? And how will you treat? And will you consider splenectomy now?
Thank you, sir. My diagnosis still remains ITP. So because we see that initially the patient has responded to IVIG, the patient was responding to steroid, the patient had a normal platelet count. Again, with the tapering of steroid, the platelet count came down. And,
I agree with you because bone marrow also shows megakaryocytic
thrombocytopenia. Yes, sir. At the initial stage, we have also done a bone marrow. It was a bit not required, but then
not required.
We know that we are dealing with an ITP case.
No. Now the question is, it is not an acute ITP. So what will you do? Sir, this after so around 3 months, 3.5 months. So
if it exceeds 3 months, then it becomes a persistent ITP.
Now the diagnosis becomes persistent ITP. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So in persistent ITP, if the initial period there was no bone marrow done, so is it recommended to bone marrow at this stage?
Is no point of doing a bone marrow right now. Even if the bone marrow was not done at the initial stage, we know that the patient has responded
to IVIG. Yeah.
So no need to do a bone marrow. No need to do a bone marrow. The patient is not an elderly patient. There is no B symptom, no splenomegaly, no lymphadenopathy. So no need to go for a bone marrow right now.
I agree with you. So Dr. how will you treat?
This treatment of persistent ITP, now since the patient is having a lower side of platelet, first of all, we have to ask the patient with the 10,000 platelet count whether the patient is having any kind of bleed or not. If the patient is having any kind of bleed, we may repeat IVIG because we need a rapid increment of the platelet count. If there is a major organ bleed, we may also consider a platelet transfusion for this patient. But if the patient is not bleeding, we can increase the dose of the steroid. We can add rituximab, and according to the recent guideline of ASH, we can go for a TPO receptor agonist.
But TPO receptor agonist is recommended for so far. Every approval is for only chronic ITP, no?
Sir, it is approved for chronic ITP, but in some cases, some papers, it has been mentioned that it can be also used as first-line agent even. Now, even if we don't consider it as a first-line agent, as a second-line agent, we can also use TPO receptor agonist in persistent ITP as well.
I think Dr. Soikat wanted to say something. Is it?
Sir, one thing I would like to mention that there is difference in guideline regarding bone marrow aspiration biopsy. Though as guideline has said that we may not do bone marrow or we should not do bone marrow, international consensus recommendation, they said if our first line agent do not work or patient relapse after first line agent, like relapse after steroid or on steroid, we can do bone marrow examination. And for another reason that for
in this case, because it is relapse, that's why. But because if those cases who do not respond at all to the primary line, you have given IVIGG or steroid, patient didn't respond at all, then you do bone marrow. Or if the patient relapse, so in this case patient has relapsed, so according to that guideline, if it is not done initially, you can do. Now.
Yeah, obviously there is no good quality evidence, so
yeah.
Can or cannot. But many Indian experts even do bone marrow examination at diagnosis. Like
I myself told you I do. If I cannot see the slide myself, I do.
And another thing I would like to mention that romiplostin by FDA approval we can use in persistent ITP or even in newly diagnosed ITP if steroid is useful.
Dr. Jasasthi, so coming to, will you consider splenectomy at this stage?
Sir, not at this stage, just 3 or 4 months has passed. We have a lot of drugs in our hand.
Okay.
We can wait for 1 year. It's a young patient because splenectomy will be coming with a lot of side effects.
I agree with you.
Not splenectomy right now.
I agree with you. Next slide, please. So she was actually counseled for coming to back to cases. So didn't go for rituximab because of some logistic issue. She was treated with dapsone and prednisolone dose again increased to 0.5 milligram per kg per day. Then prednisolone tapered off after 2 weeks and dapsone was continued. Initial platelet count normalized more than 1 lakh, but again after 2 months when she was on 100 milligram dapsone and prednisolone was tapered to 10 milligram per day. Again, platelet count dropped to 35,000. And at that time, she had only petechias. So next slide, please. So question, Dr. Somo. So Dr. Somo, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Your video? Yeah. So now, so patient has come to almost around 1 year aspas aa gaya hai, patient. Now still patient. Platelet count has come down. After 1 year, platelet count again came down to 35,000, but patient has skin bleed, but no other severe bleeding. So what will you do?
Good afternoon, everybody. The issue of ITP, the most important issue of ITP is the counseling. Before treatment, the most important part is the counseling. Counseling for the patient, counseling for the patient relatives, and I think counseling to the patient also. So the important part is not the platelet count. The important part is the bleeding manifestations, when to treat, when not to treat. Okay. So in private practice, what we see mainly that patient is not at all satisfied. If some bleeding is there, okay, some minor bleeding is there, she was very terrorized. Actually, she needs some treatment, no? So important part,
in
is
my
not
opinion,
the count.
After 1 year,
important
we should discuss the patient,
bleeding manifestations.
What, you want,
when
what
to
do
treat,
you want?
When not to
do
treat.
You want okay. some durable so, response? In, do you continue some medicine which needs to be continued for a long duration, or you need some medicine which can be completed during 1 month time? So either rituximab, second is TPO. Agonists, and third is for the durable response is splenectomy. Three options is in our hand, and we should discuss the patient that what do you want.
Okay.
So in my opinion, I feel in this case I should go for the TPO agonists, romiplostim or eltrombopag in this patient at this moment.
Okay,
also can be given.
1 minute, please. Next slide, please. So in this case, actually, patient was not bleeding and 35,000 because the count only PTK was there. So what we did, Somo, we continued the dapsone and steroid was tapered off. So she has received for a long time. After 2 months, platelet count dropped to 10,000 and now patient has developed wet purpura.
Yes.
So I think when platelet count is more than 30,000 and only occasional petechia, we might go for wait and if we, as you said, we have to counsel the patient. Yeah, that platelet count is not the improvement thing, important thing. So you have to counsel that you have very rightly said, you have to counsel the patient and then we follow the patient. And now patient has again came with 10,000 with wet purpura. So now next slide please. Now Dr. Somu, can you give rituximab now? If so, what precaution will you take and what dose? What other options do you have, excluding the TPO receptor agonist? And any role of splenectomy now? And if you do splenectomy, what will you prescribe before OT? What are vaccines and role of penicillin prophylaxis? These are the questions one by one. You have to.
Yes, we can give it rituximab now. But if you ask me honestly, I am in favor of TPO agonist. Okay, because I worked with rituximab in acute IT patient. My thesis paper is all rituximab also. So, okay, fine. Rituximab we can give, but before giving rituximab, we should do some basic investigations like hepatitis B screening, hepatitis B core antibody testing as guided by the FDA guideline. So, and the dose is very important because there are a lot of studies. I think that there are some papers I have I shared with you also. That showed that starting from 100 to 375.
Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Kalpesh, can you change the slide, please? Yes. Next slide.
Next one, I think. Yes. Here you can see a lot of studies about the different dosage of rituximab, starting from 100 milligram to 1 gram also. So at the standard dose is 375 milligram meter square. And here you can see there is no such difference excepting one study by Zhang et al. From 2012. Otherwise, it is almost similar results in the 100 and 375 milligram meter square. And in the next study, you can see in my paper also, I used 100 milligram fixed dose. In the next slide, can you show the next slide? So preferably 375 milligram meter square or 100 milligram, whatever you can use in weekly basis. You can give it. I think the patient can be given 375 milligram meter square also. But before giving whatever dose you are giving, we should do a hepatitis B screening. That is very important. And what is the next question? I think forgot.
So that is the thing. Will you recommend splenectomy at this stage? And what are the other options?
Splenectomy is a very important issue. It should discuss with the patient that. If you want some durable response, yes, though it is, and in fact, the recent study showed the infection rate after splenectomy and after giving rituximab and TPO or agonist almost equal. So you can go for splenectomy. But first, the counseling part for the surgeon is very important before the splenectomy. When the surgeon sees the platelet count 15,000, we should counsel the surgeon that when you during the operation, we need plot the splenic artery, platelet count automatically will come up. So that is very important. And before splenectomy, 14 days back, we previous 14 days prior to splenectomy, we have to give some vaccination. According to guidelines, we have to give vaccination with pneumococcal vaccine, meningococcal vaccines, as well as your Haemophilus influenzae type B vaccines. These vaccines should be completed before 14 days, as it is a planned splenectomy. So we can complete before the 14 days and a following splenectomy, we should continue the prophylaxis and the recent CDC guideline, we can continue with the amoxicillin 250 milligram OD for at least 3 years. This is the recent guideline from the CDC. Okay. Our patient, if the
Dr.
patient...
Shomo,
is, yes?
Dr. Shomo, one question for you that, would you recommend to platelet count of 15,000 to go to splenectomy? With that...
Pardon, please?
With platelet count of 15,000...
Kalpesh, can you change the slide? Next slide, next to next slide.
Do you recommend patient to go to splenectomy directly or would you like to increase the platelet count by so much?
No.
Listen, splenectomy is indicated for ITP patient, refractory chronic ITP patient, you know?
Yeah, that I know, but
it's always low. The main issue is that a surgeon who is going to do the splenectomy, we should counsel the surgeon. But
I'm not asking that. I'm asking that, would you recommend any other procedure like meantime L-thrombopag or omeprostin to increase?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. But as the question said, that without giving TPRA, first I tried with the rituximab, you know. Okay, yeah. And definitely rituximab is not the solution. If the patient
this patient didn't receive TPORA, so we can actually give TPORA before.
No, actually,
yes, we can give TPORA.
My question was excluding TPO.
Exactly.
My question was excluding TPO actually. So that's why he is not saying TPO. My question was
because it is not recommended to go to splenectomy 15,000 count, and no surgeon will take my patient actually. That is also another problem.
Yeah.
Platelet count is
now. Listen, Shaika, there are many patients in a
I know what you're trying to say, that when skin is cursed, when veining tied up, platelet count will rise, but it is actually not recommended. We know this, we have done this, but it's not recommended. This is also a legal issue.
No. What is the ideal platelet count according to the guideline?
We need 50,000 platelet count for any abdominal surgery.
No. So, I think for the splenectomy for ITP patient, it is not mentioned. It is not.
It is actually mentioned. I don't actually remember what I read, possibly in international consensus report. I will check it, but it is written that 50,000 count would be.
But
any other surgery, you know, gallbladder surgery.
I'm not any talking about any other surgery. I'm talking about ITP and splenectomy.
No, may I interrupt if you don't mind? Sir, yes. Actually, Saikat, actually, you are quite new because when you were studying, that time TPO RA has come into market, but when we were students, okay, that time it was not there. And we used to go for splenectomy at 5,000, 7,000, 8,000 platelet count. With that time, we used to give methyl prednisolone, or if affording, then IVIGG with platelet transfusion. Then, as soon as the surgeon, when there's incised the skin, there will be a little bit more bleeding. But we have given IVIGG or methyl prednisolone, and platelet transfusion is given just before the OT around 5, if SDP is there, SDP or otherwise RDP. And then, as soon as the surgeon tied the splenic artery, the platelet count will jump up. I have many experience of many splenectomy. I used to go to the OT, and madam used to counsel the surgeon, you go ahead, nothing. We will take care of the bleeding. And we have seen very few complications because of the bleeding in case of ITP and splenectomy. But you were saying, I didn't come across any guideline which is mentioning about splenectomy actually. But as you say, that is right. For any major surgery or abdominal surgery, 50,000 is the guideline. So if we consider in that way, but I have not seen, I personally have not come across any particular guideline which says the cutoff point of platelet count in splenectomy. I'm not sure. If you have, if you find out, please forward to me.
Can I make
a comment?
Yes,
yeah, yeah.
Yes, as I have been practicing hematology for a long time, we have had many occasions to carry out splenectomy with a very low platelet count. And we have never had any problems or any complications. But today, as of date, we will not dare to carry out a splenectomy with a low platelet count. Guideline or no guideline?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Your input is very much appreciated.
Siddhartho, may I come in for once?
Yes.
Yeah, the point is, you see, he's not saying that you can't do it. All Shoikat is pointing out is, as of now, today's guidelines say abdominal intervention, unqualified, as far as I know, about splenectomy or not, is probably not recommended. I mean, they have not probably mentioned splenectomy.
Yes, they have mentioned about abdominal surgery or major surgery, but
unfortunately, none of us have probably, yes, not splenectomy specifically, abdominal surgery and major surgery. Yeah. And as of now, all of us have those experiences, but we have not published it. So, we are in a bit of a soup there, right? Thank you. That's it.
Okay, Somo, you continue. So, what all vaccination you are planning to give in case of you are going for splenectomy?
Yes, yes. As I already mentioned, pneumococcal vaccines, Haemophilus influenzae type B, and meningococcal vaccine usually give and should be completed prior to 14 days before the splenectomy procedure was done. And post-splenectomy, we can continue the prophylaxis. Prophylaxis, it is a recent guideline of the CDC guideline in a splenectomy patients. We can continue with the amoxicillin 250 milligram OD. And if the patient is allergic to penicillin group of drugs, then we can go for the some macrolides with roxithromycin or azithromycin 150 milligram once a day. So these are the guidelines we should follow. And in our practical life, we also follow the Pentid 400 BD we also give in the patients following the splenectomy, penicillin G. So I think this, these things we should follow.
Yeah. So in this patient, we had given rituximab 375 milligram weekly, 4 doses. She didn't give consent for splenectomy because, as Dr. Somo mentioned, that we have to counsel them, and if they agree, then only we can go for splenectomy. So this patient didn't give consent. So we, and this time we could arrange rituximab. So we have given, also we have given along with that high dose dexamethasone. Patient responded after 1.5 months, and but again relapses after 6 months again. So next slide, please. So question to Dr. Shubham. Shubham, are you there?
Yes, sir.
So this is again, this is the case become now the chronic refractory ITP. So how will you treat? And now we can come to that portion of TPO array. The can domiplostin work in a patient who failed to respond to L-thrombopag? Can you combine both in array, TPO array? And what are the different newer agents which are in pipeline for chronic refractory ITP?
First, this is a case of chronic ITP.
Chronic
Chronic ITP, which is refractory to first line of agent.
Yes.
And also second line of agent. The rituximab is the second line.
Yeah.
So the options left are TPO agonist in the newer ages. And if we don't consider TPO agonist, then the agents will come later in the fourth question. So in the present era, the drug of choice will be definitely TPO agonist. There are three TPO agonists presently which are in use, two within India. One is romiplostim and one is L-thrombopag. And avatrombopag, I don't think it is still available in India.
Romiplostim. Yeah. Shubhamda, you are not audible. Shubhamda, you are not clearly audible.
Okay. Now?
Yeah,
is
yeah,
it audible?
It's fine now. Yeah, it's fine now.
Okay. So there are three TPO agonists is available for ITP. First is romiplostim. Second is L-thrombopag. And third is avatrombopag. So in India, the romiplostim and L-thrombopag is available. In romiplostim is given weekly once in a dose of 3 microgram per kg, and L-thrombopag the starting dose is 50, and it can be given in a low dose of 25 milligram per day also. So the second question, can romiplostim work in a patient who failed to respond to L-thrombopag? There are a few studies. Now the question is, when we'll call that the patient didn't respond to TPO agonist, either romiplostim or L-thrombopag? If we give at least 6 weeks of therapy and there is no increment of platelet count still below 20,000, then we can call it, it is a failure to this TPO agonist, that is romiplostim or L-thrombopag. It has been seen in several studies that if there is failure to one agent, we can switch to another agent. So suppose there is failure to L-thrombopag, we can switch to romiplostim and vice versa. So romiplostim can work in a patient who failed to respond to L-thrombopag. And there are a few studies where given both TPO agonists along with prednisolone in lower dose. So we can also combine both TPO agonists, but if we combine both TPO agonists, the problem or the side effects anticipated is thrombosis or thromboembolic agents. So we should take proper history that patient is not prone to the thrombosis or thromboembolic agents, thromboembolic manifestations. If we become sure there is no risk factor for these thrombosis, then we can combine both TPO agonists. Now, newer agents in pipeline for chronic refractory ITP, there are namely a few agents. The newer agents are TPO agonist. Other agents, we all know, dapsone, cyclosporine, we can combine various agents and we can give steroids in several in low dose, etc.
Those are actually old agent, newer means fostamatinib and rozanolixumab. Those are the two newer agents which have not come yet actually. I think abatrombopag, it has come abroad but not to India. So those are the few agents which are in pipeline. Abatrombopag, fostamatinib, rozanolixumab, which is a Fc receptor recycling agent. These are the...
Okay.
And Dr. Saikat, are you there?
Okay. Yes, sir. Hello, I'm there.
So,
I'm here, sir.
So these are the things I can remember. Can you remember any other newer agent?
No, sir. I only like to mention that fostamatinib is now approved. We can use, which is TPURA refractory, we can use in fostamatinib, though not available in our country.
What do you mean about rombopag? And rozanolixumab, which is a Fc receptor.
This is a recycling agent.
Yeah. And something has come from China that is recombinant human thrombopoietin receptor agonist, actually. So that is recently developed in China. It is not yet FDA approved also. Okay. So I think that concludes our discussion. Now I would like to hand over the mic to the organizer. Before that, any of the panelists or any of the senior consultant who are present.
Can I make one small comment?
Yes, ma'am.
This is a 36 years old lady with quite a refractory ITP. I would definitely do lupus antibodies and screen for lupus, because if she's positive, then an immunosuppressive drug will be very useful for her, like azathioprine or something like that.
Yes, I agree with you. Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, right. That should have been done in the workup. We have not done. Yeah, that should have been done. So, any more comments from any of the viewer, any of the senior consultant, or any of the panelists?
I just want to mention two things. One thing is in reference to use of etrombopag and romiprostim as alternate agent, whether one can be used after other. Now, Shubham has correctly pointed out they can be used. Just want to add that we know that the mechanism and the site of action of both drugs are different. As Shoikata showed in his picture, if you look at the CMPL, that is the TPO receptor, the romiprostim acts at the extramembranous site, whereas the etrombopag acts at the transmembranous part. So both drugs can be used one after other. Another thing I want to point out, sir, in your very first slide, you asked whether the type of antibody is necessary to detect before starting the therapy of ITP. No, it is not recommended like that. But there are certain studies which say that if the antibody is against GP2B3A, it has got a better prognosis than GP1B9 antibody.
There are only two studies I could find, when both are from the China actually.
Yes,
I didn't find a very large RCT.
No, sir. The population was not very large, and they have told that the media, the platelet destruction in which GP2B3A is involved, that involves a Fc receptor mediated platelet destruction. So that has got a better prognosis since it responds to drugs better than GP1B9, which is a Fc receptor independent platelet destruction. That's the thing I wanted to point out.
Thank you. Anyone want to add?
Yes, sir. So I would just like to add something that regarding platelet transfusions in the emergency condition of active bleeding in case of ITP. So a lot of studies have been conducted. None has shown that giving platelets actually increases antiplatelet antibodies. So we should treat it as an emergency situation as such. And if required, then we should go ahead with platelet transfusion. And that's all.
Thank you, Dr. Siddhartha Shankar Rai, for the wonderful panel discussion and also the esteemed panelists. All our requests, please stay. There is a couple of questions is there, so we'll discuss one by one. And anybody can give his or her the expert opinion. So moving to the question one by one. So the first question is the 12-year-old boy with immune thrombocytopenia. So how do you choose the first line of the therapy? This goes to Dr. Subramanian, but yes, other can also free to give the answer. Dr. Subramanian, please.
Yeah, good evening, sir. 12-year boy with immune thrombocytopenia. If it is newly diagnosed, I have already mentioned as per the guidelines, whether it is, we have to examine the patient, whether it is grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, what type of bleeding it is. If it is in grade 1, grade 2, look for the platelet count. If the platelet count is more than 20,000, there is only skin bleeds, you can observe. Only if the platelet count is less than 20,000 and there is a mucosal bleed, and if the patient is far away from a hospital setting, hospitalize the patient, start oral steroids. And if the child is coming with a life-threatening bleed at presentation, go for agents like IVIG or anti-D or methylprednisolone IV to increase the platelet count rapidly.
Right. So in terms of the curative potential, in terms of the curative potential of the first line of the drug, you have the steroid. The steroid means somnacotyl is there, means the prednisolone, there is a dexamethasone is there, and also you have IVIG also there, and also the anti-D is there. So in terms of the long-term remission rate, so which drugs you choose in your clinic?
Okay, sir.
Terms of the long-term response rate.
Because none of the yes,
because the IVIG and anti-D you give maximum
4 weeks, sir. Maximum 4 to 6 weeks, they have a response rate, and then after that, we need to add something. With steroids, with tapering, at least 60% of the patients they remain. Mostly, I have shown a slide where the child and the presentation with a triggering viral infection with no severe bleeds, they go into a long-term remission. Adults don't go into remission, but if they cross 3 months, if they go into persistent stage or chronic stage, we have to add agents as per the choices. We need to maintain a safe platelet count above 30,000.
Yes. Anybody have any comment on this issue?
Start your video.
Dr. Somunil, please on your video.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Dr. Somo, anything you want to add in terms of the long-term response rate?
ITP is it is very difficult to predict for the long-term response for ITP at least. Who will go?
What the evidence is?
Hello?
Evidence
for the pediatric ITP, for the pediatric patients ITP, definitely if we can continue the dexamethasone, high dose dexamethasone for 4 days, and we can repeat it after 14 days for 2, it shows maximum benefit.
Right. So Dr. Somo has rightly pointed out the important issue, because if you use the dexamethasone in the frontline setting of the children ITP, there's a different dosage schedule is available. You can give the continuously 4 days, then it can off, or you can repeat it. But if you follow up the patient in the long term, yes, the remission rate of the dexamethasone is higher comparing to the other prednisolone and IVIG and anti-D.
But
I want to add something. The present guidelines, both the ASH 2019 guidelines and the International Working Group consensus, that regarding all the three steroids, the regarding prednisolone and dexamethasone, what I found interesting, I should share with the audience. Both are of same potency. Both are of equivalent potency. Okay. The good thing about dexamethasone or prednisolone is that about dexamethasone is that you give for only 4 days, the adherence of therapy is better compared to prednisolone. And right, as far as the response assessment at the end of 1 year, it's only 60 to 66% for both the agents. They have not given any preferences. I was also having the same impression. What
evidence is that all the steroid is similar. But yes, there is a head-to-head comparison trial is there. At least the 2 trials have been published. There is a slight better long-term response rate with the dexamethasone. Next, anybody want to say something, or we can move to the second question?
I just wanted to make one statement. Yes. I consider IVIG as a stopgap measure for treatment of acute hemorrhage in ITP.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, that is not ruled out. For anything, a life-threatening bleed, ma'am. Suppose somebody comes with IC bleed. Suppose somebody comes with a GI bleed. Or suppose somebody is more than 50 years with comorbidities, go for IVIG. And present era with COVID infections, go for IVIG, ma'am. That is physician discretion. That is not wrong.
Dr. Subramanian, another question for you. You have another question. In terms of the IVIG and anti-D, if you look the cost issue, So the NTD is quite cheaper comparing to the intravenous immunoglobulin.
Yes, sir. So yes, sir.
What will be your advice?
Listen,
in terms of the cost, in terms of the response rate.
Sir, IV, IG and NTD, but the thing is that I prefer IVIG, though the cost is high, but IVIG has also unique side effects, headache, aseptic meningitis, which has to check the creatinine. But the NTD, though the cost is low, but the US people are not in favor of so much of NTD. They have said that there are black box warnings, you should counsel the patient. Yes, it's okay, fine. We can use in emergency setting in India, it's available, it's cost effective, no issues.
Anybody want to comment on this issue? Dr. Santanuda, anything? Dr. Santanuda, please.
No, I mean, that's okay. I mean, steroids, in this particular case, I think steroids should do the job well. Whether you choose prednisolone or...
No, Santanuda, sir. IVIG, NTD.
Oh, I'm sorry. I missed IVIG, IVIG and NTD. Yes, I personally would prefer IVIG. In children, you know, it's safer than NTD. And I rarely use NTD with so many black box warnings.
Black box warnings.
If you can have those IVIG, in children it is less costly than adults for IVIG.
Yes, yes.
So it is a possibility that you can in practical life.
The only issue of the NTD is the low hemoglobin. You cannot use it. And there is a Rh negative patient. There is a less response rate. Post-plenectomy patient, there is a less response rate. Otherwise, there is no major problem in terms of the NTD, but yes, the availability is the issue for giving the NTD. Next, moment to the next important issue, that the 65-year male with isolated thrombocytopenia. So, do you advise the bone marrow examination?
Absolutely, sir. I will go for a bone marrow examination.
So, you do bone marrow aspiration and the bone marrow biopsy together, or you should do the bone marrow aspiration only?
No, both, sir. I will do both.
So, what are the indication you should... order for the bone marrow?
Sir, in a, the guidelines clearly mentions anyone above 60 years presenting with isolated thrombocytopenia, go for a bone marrow study, sir. They have...
I think if it is a frank case of isolated thrombocytopenia without any organomegaly, lymphadenopathy, fever, whatever it may be...
Sir, Shomo, age. Shomo,
the age matters.
Shomo, age is matter. Clearly. It's more, yes, 60 years.
Shomo, please hold on. Shomo, continue. Yes.
If the patient having isolated thrombocytopenia without, you know, organomegaly, lymphadenopathy or any abnormal cells, whatever, no history of fever, is the age really matters?
Yes.
About 60. It is the evidence. Is it evidence-based?
No,
and what is
the guidelines, Shomo, is mentioning that above 60, you should go for a marrow examination with an isolated thrombocytopenia.
Okay. I would like to mention only one thing, that 5% of MDS patient can present with only
as a
hematologist, I don't want to miss a case of MDS.
Right. So yeah, the thing is that Dr. Subbarnel is rightly pointed out, in terms of this isolated thrombocytopenia, even though there is a peripheral smear is normal, the WBC is normal, hemoglobin also normal, there is no clinical abnormality, you should go ahead with the bone marrow examination to try to find out not only the ITP, but the MDA, sometimes the aplastic anemia is also evolving. So these things should roll out. Yes, Dr. Siddhartha Sankara.
Yeah, actually, I would like to do aspiration, biopsy, and cytogenetics also. I will collect the sample because in my mind also, above 60, there is a possibility of MDS and a bone marrow is a procedure. I cannot repeat it and again. So I will collect the cytogenetic sample also. I will do bone marrow aspiration and biopsy. Collect the cytogenetic samples and bone marrow aspiration report. If so, within one day it will come. Cytogenetics report I can keep in the heparin for the next day also. Okay. Right. And so I would like to keep the cytogenetics also.
Right. So bone marrow aspiration, bone marrow biopsy, along with the cytogenetics, you have to send in the single setting to try to rule out the other cause of the isolated thrombocytopenia. Very right. So the another important question is that, is there any role of the TPU in the first line of the setting? Because sometimes we can give the several examples that the 30 years male patient have been given the first line of treatment with IVIG. After 3 to 4 days, the platelet count is again 10,000 with the active bleed. So sometimes we add the steroid, the patient is not responding. Sometimes we can add the NTD also, but the patient is not responding. So okay, in these challenging cases, how do you treat this patient or any role of the TPU in the first line of the setting? Do it recommended.
Can I ask you?
Yes. আমি বলি সমো শেষ করে দি
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ
তারপরে বলিস
Yes.
And the thing is that, sir, the TPORA, the guidelines, both the ASH guidelines and the IMWC does not endorse as the frontline agent. But as you mentioned, they can be used when they are not responsive to IVIG, not responsive to IV methylprednisolone, or not responsive to INTD. Then TPO can be agent. We cannot pick from Romi or Eltropran. Either of the agents can be used. And still, there is no head-on randomized control trial between the agents or comparing both the agents, whether they can be used in the frontline cell. But a physician who feels an emergency it can be used, it can be tried.
Right.
But as of now, in the guidelines.
Dr. Somo, please.
I don't know about the studies, but personally, in severe diabetic patient, I have used two patients. In high diabetic patients, in which patient steroid is really a very difficult thing to give. So I have used patients in first line setting. Patient was not able to purchase the IVIG. So I have used in two patients romiplostim in first line settings. And it worked like a brilliant.
I will personally advise you, Dr. Shom.
Yes, Dr. Subbanil.
Dr.
Subbanil's voice is not audible. His voice is breaking. Surmila ma'am, any comment from this issue? In terms of the TPO, please unmute. Surmila ma'am, please unmute. So, any comment on this issue?
Well, I was not listening very carefully.
Achha, so, the question is that sometimes it is very difficult patient where the first line of the drug, the none is effective for treating the newly diagnosed patient of the ITP. So the patient is bleeding, the platelet count in 10,000 after using the steroid, IVIG and NTD. So there is any role of the TPO agonist in this patient, though it is not recommended by the any guidelines. What is your opinion in terms of your practice?
Well, if it is a primary refractory ITP, then I will definitely use TPO agonist.
Right. So, Dr. Santur, any comment on this?
I have just one comment. You know, when you have a difficult case, then sometimes, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Sorry. When you have a difficult case, sometimes, as Dr. Baul has said, that you can go beyond the guidelines. And in this case, probably TPORA is...
Right.
I mean, you can definitely give it a try because these are not ordinary cases, you know. When you have primary refractory ITP, then these are not cases which is going to respond very well.
Absolutely. So sometime we can use the TPO agonist, either the eltromup and the romiplostim in case of the very bad patient who is not responding to the first line of the drug. So the next question is that any role of the combination treatment of the refractory ITP, Dr. Soikot?
Yeah, obviously, I have shown a lot of combination therapy before TPARA, ADA, we used Dapsone plus steroid, we used Aja plus Danazole, even Cyclosporine, MMF, Azathioprine, any type of combination and all type of combination are used. And
in the era of the TPO agonist, any trial of this?
Yes, with eltromobag and romiplostin, immunosuppressive agent is combined. And also...
Also,
other agent like TPORA plus fostamatinib plus IVIG. There are different trials because there is no good quality of evidence, but these are tried. Combination of TPORA with immunosuppressive agent and with FC blocking agent.
Right. So, Dr. Ankita, any question, any comment on this issue?
Tufan sir, can I say something?
Yes. After the Ankita, Dr. Ankita, please.
Okay, sir. Sir, regarding this, I just wanted to say that it is there in different trials. Like Dr. Baul has already pointed out rightly that it's not in the first line recommendation, but still, in different trials, it has been seen that romiplostim can be used. Though it's a second-line agent, it can be used in case of newly diagnosed ITP. Like you rightly said that once the steroids, IVIG, anti-D seem to be not working. So that's all.
Now we are discussing the combination treatment of the ITP, refractory ITP. Means in the era of the TPO agonist, there is a dendrobium is there, romiplostim is there, then there is other immunosuppressant is there. So there is several trial is there for the combination of the drug. If you combine with eltromopag, yes, with androgen, you can combine the eltromopag along with the cyclosporine. You can combine eltromopag with the mycophenolate. So the response rate is quite high.
Yes.
Somo, please.
Can I share one experience with you?
Yes, yes.
In one patient whom finance was the matter, so I reduced the dose of eltromopag. Okay. And it was 25 milligram twice a week. But with that dose, patient was failed to maintain the platelet count. So I used steroid plus eltrombopag. Oh no, steroid very minimum dose 10 milligram plus eltrombopag, and it created a magic. Platelet is 80,000, 85,000. So definitely there is a role of combination therapy with eltrombopag, with romiplostim, with steroid.
Yeah, there is also good studies with romiplostim with 2.5 or 5 milligram of steroid.
Exactly.
And they produce good results.
Potentiates the activity of romiplostim. That's I think that showed.
Right. Dr. Sarkot is absolutely right. There is a romiplostim data on this aspect is there. So move on to the another question. So in terms of this eltrombopag vis-a-vis the romiplostim, so you have a two drug in your hand for managing the refractory ITP. So in your practice, which drug you choose and why?
So there is no head-to-head trial. So we don't have any scientific data, and as the impotent patient, and we should discuss with patient if what the patient wants, a regular injection or oral drug, and if any liver dysfunction, dietary restriction, patient preference, and cost is matter. Eltrombopag cost around 50,000 per month, and romiplostim around 10,000-12,000 per month. So these are the issues we should discuss with patient and decide.
Right. So the important thing is that in terms of the, if you consider the cost issue, the romiplostim is slightly cheaper than the eltrombopag. And if you consider the patient convenience, the romiplostim has to be given subcutaneous, eltrombopag has to be taken oral. The third important thing is that in terms of this, the romiplostim and the eltrombopag, though the effectivity is similar in both the cases, sometimes the patient prefers to take the oral medicine. And the fourth important issue is that in terms of the adverse effect, both the drug causes liver dysfunction. Eltrombopag also causes liver dysfunction, the romiplostim also can cause the liver dysfunction. So as Dr. Suikoti rightly pointed out, we have to discuss the issue to the patient and the patient relative. We can choose the any one of the drugs. But in terms of the efficacy, if we consider the efficacy, though the trial is saying that more or less similar, so there is a little bit difference in terms of efficacy of the romiplostim vis-a-vis eltrombopag in Indian setting. So I want to know the experience from this esteemed panelist in terms of the romiplostim. In your practice, in terms of the efficacy in Indian patient. Dr. Somu, please.
Yeah, though the data is very low in my patient, I am talking about my patients. I have five or six patients of eltrombopag and romiplostim, and 10 patients of eltrombopag. Definitely, the romiplostim efficacy, I think, little bit better in my patients. Okay. And in few patients, I switched from eltrombopag to romiplostim also. But one issue when we are doing the trial in NRS, as you have noticed in the romiplostim, after the stoppage of the romiplostim, there is a rebound thrombocytopenia. I think, I don't know what will happen to this patient, but we should be careful about the rebound thrombocytopenia after the stoppage of the romiplostim, which we have faced during the trial in NRS.
At that time, actually, we did not have any discontinuation protocol. No.
After the trial ended, we have to stop it abruptly.
Yeah.
That's why there is a problem.
Nowadays, it is not recommended.
But practice is the different. Dr. Somila, ma'am, any comment on this issue? In terms of efficacy of the romiplostim vis-a-vis the eltrombopag in your practice?
Well, I have had no issues with romiplostim. I found it just as good. And in the small number of cases where I've used, it has been successful. We have titrated the dose. It is easy to titrate. And it is given once a week. Only thing is, it's a subcutaneous injection. That is a bit of a problem. But I'll mention one of my cases as a sort of a thought-provoking thing. This was an elderly lady who had come from North Bengal, and she had a refractory ITP. So we gave her L-thrombopag and sent her home. And she responded well and was lost for follow-up for 2 years. After 2.5 years, she came back with a severe thrombocytopenia. And this time we discovered that her counts were getting low. So we did a bone marrow and full workup, and we found that she has got a liver disease now. Now, whether this liver disease is because of L-thrombopag or she had it earlier, we had not been able to diagnose it, I do not know. But we give a routine workup like an ultrasound and all that. There was no problem with that. But this is just a caveat to say that when we use these things, we must follow up our patients properly.
Right. Dr. Santur Masu, any comment on this issue in terms of efficacy of romiplostim vis-a-vis L-thrombopag in your practice? Dr. Santur Masu, please. Possibly he is unable to hear us.
He's there.
Are you talking about me?
Yes.
Right. Right. You see, sorry. Calls came in. So
in terms of efficacy of the romiplostim and L-thrombopag in your practice, any difference of the efficacy?
I gave steroids with romiplostim. The man had a count of around 50,000-60,000. He had a CNS bleed initially. And after adding a bit of steroids, I had to, because he had to go for a vitrectomy. And so I thought that a little bit of higher counts were necessary for vitrectomy. And with adding a little bit of steroids, the counts went through the roof. I mean, this is something very unusual. I've never seen from 60,000 to 1,60,000. I mean, this is something good. I never seen this with L-thrombopag, but I did see this with romiplostim.
Right.
Adding a little bit of steroids.
Dr. Siddhartha Shankar is there?
Yes.
So what is your, in terms of the romiplostim vis-a-vis the L-thrombopag efficacy in your practice?
Actually, I have not used much romiplostim in my practice. I have used few L-thrombopag. L-thrombopag was good in all my patients, but thing is that what Dr. Somo told, no, that after stopping, there is usually abrupt decrease in the platelet count. Nowadays, as Dr. Saikat rightly said, that previously we used to stop abruptly. That's why now there is a recommendation how you can stop. So we have to follow that recommendation and then we can stop. Then we have to find out. In my practice, I didn't have much experience about romiplostim.
Now, the thing is that the Saikat is telling the different issue and the Somo is telling in the same issue. The trial is designed like that, but it is never recommended that you stop the drug abruptly. You have to continue the drug and try to diminish the platelet count. The trial have been designed in such a way that you have to give in the drug for the 2 to 3 months and then stop. This is the trial. This is not a clinical practice. In the clinical practice, you have to continue the drug and you have to follow the platelet count. And then you have to follow the guideline for the discontinuation of the drug and all these things in there. So as the Somo is rightly pointed out and the Sormila ma'am also rightly pointed out, in terms of the efficacy, if you look for the romiplostim and the L-thrombopag, in particularly the Indian patients, I think the romiplostim is slightly superior than the L-thrombopag. We have plenty of the examples there. After giving the L-thrombopag, even in the full dosage of the 75 mg, the patient is not responding. But yes, after giving the romiplostim of the 5 micrograms subcutaneous weekly doses, and the platelet count is started rising. So there is some advantage of the romiplostim, I think, is there in Indian patient, but the explanation is still not there. And also, head-to-head comparison is not there. But yes, in our clinical practice, in terms of the efficacy, romiplostim is slightly better than the L-thrombopag in terms of the efficacy for rising the platelet count.
So one thing I would like to mention for our audience, that though in romiplostim vial it's written in 250 microgram, actually 375 microgram of drug is there. So sometimes we use full vial, and so the dose, sometimes it's overdose. Actually, when I started using, I didn't know the fact that the vial contains 375 milligrams. It's not.
No. That is different issue. That is different. The two vials are there, 250, 500.
I am talking
about.
I am talking about 250 milligram vial.
Yes.
It's 250 milligram vial per 0.5 ml. Actually, the diluent is 0.72 ml.
It will be 0.5 ml. When we add
We have to give 0.72 ml and give patient 0.5 ml. We have to discard the rest.
When we add 0.72 ml to the powder, it will be 0.5 ml. 0.5 ml contains 250 microgram of the drug.
The thing is that Dr. Soumi has rightly pointed out, though we are adding the 0.72 ml, but if you exactly draw the amount of in your syringe, it will around the 0.5 to sometimes the it is slightly higher than that, but you're absolutely right. So we are not giving the 0.72 ml of the drug. So we are giving the 250 mg drug, but yes, depending upon the weight, you have to adjust the dose. Another question is there. I'll go quickly to the questions. So the question from Dr. Prakash Kumar Mondal, as we are the very important question he raised, that in terms of the ITP, the what platelet count you allow your patient to go to the splenectomy safely, though we have been discussing a little bit in this issue of the platelet count. So he's raised the important issue for safe platelet count. We already addressed this issue. Though there is a guideline is that in terms of the abdominal surgery, the 30,000, 50,000 is there, but in ITP, it is very difficult to maintain that platelet count. Sometimes we can go ahead with the surgery with the low platelet count also. Dr. Siddhartha Sankara has been beautifully explained these things. So we can go ahead with the low platelet count, but yes, nowadays there is a counseling is very, very important. The consenting is very, very important. And also the risk of the bleeding during surgery has to be conveyed to the patient and the patient relative. And nowadays, there is a combination of the drug is there. You can use it before the splenectomy to raise the platelet count a little bit. But yes, if it is emergency, you can go ahead with the low platelet count with the surgery. So we have been already discussed this issue. The another question from the Tezoni, that what is the type of the response of the ITP? So how early the response is there? Anybody can address this issue in terms of the newly diagnosed ITP, I think. Dr. Subranil, you can give this answer.
Well, sir,
giving the first line of the drug, so in terms of the early response.
The responses start, we should check the platelet count after 48 to 72 hours. The IVIG responses within 4 days, the NTD also 2 to 7 days, and methylpred also, the response is also within 48 to 72 hours.
Right. So another question from Dr. Ananto, that the important question he has been raised, that what would be the minimum platelet count to conceive and what is the minimum platelet count for a cesarean section?
Pregnancy, sir, the current guidelines says platelet count more than in a patient with ITP lady can conceive with anything around more than 30,000. No need to make it 1 lakh. But if the lady is nearing delivery, then a platelet count for uraxial is around 50 to 80,000. No necessity to make it 1 lakh, but 50 to 80,000 would be safe around delivery. And then there are some protocols to manage the the newborn after delivery. And it's a separate topic.
Right.
But throughout, it is more than 30,000.
Right. Dr. Amarnath is asking that, can you use the NTD in RH negative patient? Anybody can ask Dr. Somo or
NTD is not indicated in RH negative patients because what is the mechanism of action of NTD? That is very important. NTD acts in the D positive, that is the RH positive RBC. It will kill the RBC, the macrophage will engulf the RBC, and it will leave the platelet to increase. That is the basic mechanism of NTD in ITP in a nutshell. So it should be used in RH positive patient only.
Preferably, right. Another question from Dr. Nivedita Moulik, that we have been discussing some issue of the BBV, that is called the blood-borne virus. So he is asking, what do you exactly mean the blood-borne virus? Dr. Ankita,
Sir, by the blood-borne viruses, we mean HIV, HCV in context to ITP. So, yes. In context to ITP, we should measure, we should diagnose, I mean, we should check for these viruses before proceeding.
Right. So, I think we have been addressing all the questions raised by our the audience. And we have a fruitful discussion. Now, the things, all the discussion, we are at the end of our discussion in terms of the lecture and the panel discussion. Next, on moving to the Dr. Shantanu Basu for the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Tufan. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, right. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, speakers, for this wonderful session. I congratulate Dr. Shubhranil Baul for this comprehensive start, taken up very well by Dr. Shoikot Dotto from North Bengal Medical College. And of course, and we move to Dr. Siddhartha Shankar Rai, who did a very good job of the session, which is a very practical one, you know, after a theoretical introduction, we do need the practices and how to use them up. And thank you, the participants in the panel discussion, Dr. Ankita Sen, Dr. Shazia Gulshan, Dr. Shubham Bhattacharya, Dr. Shomo Mukherjee, and Dr. Joshua Chakraborty. Last, but I must thank Intas Pharmaceutical, as I was told by Dr. Tolai, that they have been giving us educational grants for this one. Thank you very much for helping us with educational grants. We need some more of these webinars in the future for this. I must also thank Mice Ideas, who has made this possible, of this webinar, Rajesh, Kalpesh, and Neeldeep, and the whole team there. And of course, the entire audiences who have joined us. I was told that we have nearly 212 attendees. Also, foreign international attendees from Bangladesh, from Sri Lanka, and I don't know, maybe from United States. Thank you all for making this a great success. And last but not the least, thank you, Professor Dolai, for this wonderful seminar from PSH, and Dr. Chandra for giving us this opportunity in with the introduction. Thank you all once more, and good night.
Good night, everybody. But sir, just the thing is that, as Dr. Shantanu Basu rightly pointed out, we have a 1220 attendees in the portal. There are 26 from the Bangladesh and also the 12 from the Sri Lanka. So thank you, everybody, for joining us, and good night, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Night.